Hello, welcome to Celluloid Mirror. I'm your hostess, Betty St. Laveau. On this show, we talk about film definitions, movie stars, and movies. Today, we're doing a follow-up to nuclear movies, and this is part two. I think, from what I remember, I did a promo on the show because I'd forgotten my notes. So we're sort of going to crash right through these three excellent movies, two of which I've seen, one that I have not, and out of the three of them, one of them I am totally obsessed with. So first we'll check out Where the Wind Blows. It's a 1986 film, animated disaster movie, and it was directed by Jimmy Murakami, and it's based on Raymond Briggs' comic book of the same name. The plot basically consists of an older couple living out in rural England somewhere, and they are an older couple, and they are slightly on the naive side when it comes to preparing for nuclear holocaust. They think about the good old days back during World War II when they were little, and there was optimism and everything was going to be okay throughout the land. And the husband, Jim, as he's trying to set up protection for the house and Hilda in turn is going around puttering and doing her ordinary household work. The animation coupled with the loving ways that they have towards one another makes this an extremely poignant film, and also gives a focus on the fact that there are generations out there who don't understand what happens during a nuclear holocaust, unfortunately. So thank you, Kellogg Hubbard Library, again. I got this through interlibrary loan. You can watch it on YouTube in still form. The animation, I really wanted to go into how Raymond Briggs brought about the idea and how Jimmy Murakami combined his art with it, but we're going to do a part three because that is a whole nother part of this excellent movie. Now, the second movie that I wanted to talk about, that I don't know too much about, I haven't seen it, is The War Game, and it was produced by the BBC Network. Let's see if I can... Might not have my notes on that. Well, I do. Excellent. All right. So The War Game was actually made in 1966, and it's told in a fake documentary style. They didn't want to air it on television. They thought that there would be mass suicides. I don't know if I can find this one on YouTube, but... This film was eventually televised during the 40th anniversary of the bomb being dropped on Hiroshima. And I think that that was brave of the BBC to do and also a bit necessary because, again, there are generations out there who don't understand that nuclear or anything is dangerous. This is the war game. It's more of a, it focuses more on the army than it does on the civilian point of view in When the Wind Blows. And it's sort of a, could be a transitional movie to Threads. Like I would suggest, it's not very cheery, but watch Where the Wind Blows first and then The War Game second and then Threads. Last. So the movie that brought about this episode that I totally love and am a little bit obsessed with is the movie Threads. And it's a 1984 movie. It was produced by Nine Network. And I think in the last episode, I basically touched on the plot. The town of Sheffield live Ruth Beckett and Jimmy Kemp. They're about to have a baby, they decide to get married, and as all of this is taking place, the winds of war are blowing around them. planes are flying overhead, and the news is grim. What made this movie interesting for me is not only the spectacular special effects, but the fact that the patriarchs of both families, Jimmy's dad and Ruth's dad, they seem to have a sense of what's going on. And I really like the fact that I'm not saying that the mothers were not as smart or instinctive, but the patriarchs of the family, they were really checking out the news and keeping their ear to the ground. They sort of knew that something was going to, something was about to change in their community. So according to Wikipedia, the genre is drama, sci-fi, horror, and war. War is horrible. The filmmakers of this movie did a fantastic job. This is a made-for-TV movie. It's one of those made-for-TV movies that are better produced than some feature-length movies, okay? I would suggest everyone check this movie out. I think that you would enjoy it. It is depressing in the extreme. It's not for the faint of heart. This was shown in schools in England, and I think that it would be a I think it's the subject of this movie, the medium that's presented by, is a good way to teach people about what's going on when it comes to nuclear disasters. All right, so I know I glanced over these three movies kind of quickly today because I also wanted to talk about not only some a nostalgia that I have for some 90s films that came out in the late 90s, early 2000s. But I also wanted to talk about the rural revolution that happened at CBS decades ago. Now, back in the prehistoric times of television, there were not one, not two, there were three networks and something called UHF. UHF was sort of like what Orca is, basic cable, your local television station. But the big three, ABC, CBS, and NBC, ruled the roost. Television would go off the air around, I think, 12:30, 1 a.m. at night, a ghastly rendition of, I think, Star Spangled Banner would play, but very eerie, very scary, you know, not cheery at all. I think it's Star Spangled Banner. It's been so long since I remember it, but once in a while, you can still catch that eeriness of that particular time of night through old retro movies, okay? So James T. Aubrey was a very famous film television executive who ruled the roost at a couple networks back in the 60s. And wanting to talk about Mr. Aubrey, again, thank you, Kellogg Hubbard Library, I turned to them to take out on interlibrary loan The Love Machine, written by Jackie Suzanne. Jackie and I happen to share the same birthday. I really like her writing. The book is fictionalized. They would like to say it's Roman de Clef, to quote Ms. Suzanne, but the book feels very, it touches on what television is today. For instance, that book, it was published back in 1969. She actually uses the word hater. One would think that that's a modern term, especially when it comes to social platforms. But the fact that Jacqueline Suzanne used that word in a book when it pertained to other TV executives is very interesting to me. At any rate, the rural purge was something that was quite shocking. A more urbanized, sophisticated view of comedy was hitting the television airwaves, and everything that had a tree in it was canceled. According to Pat Buttram, he played Mr. Haney on Green Acres, and he also, he's in one of my favorite movies in the whole world, I'll remember in a second. He's a great actor. At any rate, he said anything with a tree was canceled, including Lassie, all right? So we're a little bit short on time. I'm going to go into that more in my next episode. But I just want to talk about James T. Aubrey and Even Fred Silverman, who I thought that he had started out ABC, but he had been at, I guess he'd been at CBS. Anyway, Mr. Aubrey had a very interesting life. He was married to a woman named Phyllis Thaxter, who was on at least 5 or 6 episodes of Alfred Hitchcock Presents. She was a good actress. He was president of CBS between 1959 and 1965. He gave the people what they wanted. And also he had a temper, but he also knew what he knew what he liked. And you couldn't cross him. You know, when he had made up his mind about something, he'd made it up. Allegedly, and I guess this is a fact, he had a glacial eyes. His eyes were very cold. And in A Love Machine, Jackie Suzanne's hero, and actually it's one of her most positive books in a crazy way, has these glacial blue eyes. So when Aubrey found out what Jackie was up to, he said to her, "Make me a mean son of a bitch." Okay, so I think that that's pretty funny. So we'll go more into the Real Revolution, and then we're also going to talk about the Lawrence Welk Hee-Haw Counter-Revolution Polka that went down after everything with the tree was canceled on CBS. So, I would love to go into that, but what turned out with both the Lawrence Welk show and with Hee-Haw is that they're both syndicated, and Mr. Welk ended up not retiring until 1982, and Hee-Haw continued on there until 1993. So they had a pretty good thing going despite what went down with the Royal Purge. Okay, so I believe that is it for me today. I'm your hostess, Betty St. Laveau. A little bit of a short show. Next episode, we'll go more into Mr. Aubrey. We'll hit my 90s movies, New Best Friend, Gossip, and The In Crowd. Two of those made the year 2000 and one in 2002, but I like to call them my late 90s movies. And then I'll also probably touch very briefly on the fact that St. Laveau World Cinema is going to do a couple episodes on film festivals. So, until next time, I hope that you all are doing great. I want to thank Kellogg Hubbard Library for its continued support over the years, and also Capital Copy that has helped me immensely formatting my posters. Did I already thank Gendron Building? I think I did. I want to thank Gendron Building. Concrete builders doing concrete construction for 50 years, and of course the crew here at Orca for helping me talk to you all about movies, etc. And lastly, to my mom, Sharon Audella Warfield Paris Otisani Klarich, who taught me a lot about movies. Until next time, babes, stay away from those bad movies. Ciao.